I want to make sure you're paying attention all these weeks. So what's the first candle that we lit on the first Sunday of Advent? One person, raise a hand. Anybody? No one's raising their hand? Oh, man. Raise your hand. What was the first candle of the Advent season did we light?
The shortest one.
You didn't raise your hand, but I'll take it. Okay. Yes, and I know it's the shortest candle, okay? Because it's been burning for going on now four weeks. Wow, you're tough. Did we not get enough sleep? All right. I want to say, the first week we talked about hoping to know him better through this season. And I want to say, whether you realize it or not, I think that the soul cries out to want to know God better. And I think a lot of the ways it shows itself is when we decide to get up and come together.
Amen.
Whenever you take the time out to pray, whenever you take the time out to open up your Bible, you're hoping, there's a hope that goes on in our hearts to want to know him and to know him better. I'm going to try this again, all right? Second week of Advent, raise your hand. What candle did we light? Tony. Peace. Thank you. See, someone who can play well with others, all right? Light the candle of peace. And we spoke about inviting God, the peace of God, into our mess, right? Because by nature, you know, we can tend to get pretty messy. You know, there's a real slogan that's been kind of going around for some time now when people say, oh, that person's a hot mess, right? Well, just that's a human nature. It's just life gets messy and we seem to get turned around in it quite often and we need to find his peace. And then last week, we lit what candle? And this one should be easy. It was only last week. Yes.
Joy.
Joy. Very good. Nice and clear. She raised a hand. All right. And last week we talked about turning on the lights. Because in our culture, it's very easy to become dim. And things can get dark pretty quickly. And a lot of times we come up across people who are lacking joy. And God's calling us to be the joy givers and the joy bringers, right? Especially at this time of year. And how we do that is that we bring his light. And in essence, I think that even if the lights are off in people's homes and in their hearts, God can use us to turn that on. And in this week, we're going to light the candle of love. And this week I want to talk to you about true identity. True identity. Now, we live in a world and a culture right now where identity is an issue, right? Identity fraud, right? Or people going online or on Facebook and posing to be someone that they're not. And as authorities go on and they pose as someone that they're not in hopes to catch the person that's trying to fool maybe an innocent child, right? But identity is an issue. It's really a form of terrorism, in a sense, where people take another posture and pose to be something or someone they're not in order to deceive someone else. And it can be an issue. It strikes fear in a lot of our hearts, right? We deal with the identity theft, and we talk about finances being taken and people being deceived, and we have companies like LifeLock that have come along and have built a reputation in trying to protect people and what belongs to them, and especially their identity. You know, I don't know about you, but I know people, you know, when you go to the store, if you do too many returns, they want to scan your license. I am married to someone who refuses to have her license scanned. It's not going to happen. You are not getting her identity. And you know, it's just a troubling time that we live in. And so we kind of have to ask the question, you know, what's it take to protect our identity? And today I want to talk about God's identity, which never needs any protecting. We know that God is love. The Bible clearly states that that he is love. And to take hold of that identity is really what is so, so important. Each of us have been touched by his character and his person, and that's what draws us to come together and to be together and to grow together. So this morning I want to start off with just a simple verse that really speaks about his identity and his purpose for coming. Luke 19:10. And I want to give you two translations this morning, the English Standard Version and the Contemporary English Version. And I do that for a reason this morning. Because I really do, I do believe it's important that that our culture, more than ever, and I'm just using this as a simple example, can hear about his true identity in language that they can understand. In the English Standard Version, it says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." It's a translation that is a word for word. So when we go into the Old Testament, if you're in the Old Testament, they try to take the Hebrew word and try to find a matching English word that will really bring that message to life. But when you look at the contemporary English version, it's a thought for thought. They take the thought and they try to bring it forward and connect it to a thought that is easily understood today. And their version says, "The Son of Man came to look for and to save people who are lost." Now, it's a small difference between seek and look. But you know as well as I do, if you were trying to connect with somebody and you ran into them, you wouldn't say, "You know, I've been seeking you all this week," instead of saying, "I've been looking for you all this week." Is an importance of getting the message across and portraying who he is in a language that can be easily understood. And so there's an importance in that, and that in doing that, that they get the message that God is love, and that they understand what we're saying to them, that they understand his nature. Some years ago, when my Uncle Bob was alive, he was coming home from work, and he got a flat tire. And I was with a couple of friends who were Christians, and we went to the site where my uncle had pulled over, helped him change his tire, and got him home. And my uncle was grateful. And my uncle was open to having us come back to the house. We had coffee, and we were talking. And my uncle asked a question, or kind of alluded to how grateful he was that we took the time, that my friends took the time to actually come out and help. And basically, what he was giving them was an opportunity to say the reason why. But in some respects, it was a missed opportunity. Because they had an opportunity to explain the love of God, but instead of using language that my uncle could digest and actually kind of reflect upon, it was language that he couldn't get at all. And it left him a little puzzled. And it kind of made him wonder, you know? He was grateful for what happened, but there was something lost in the message. With Christ's coming, there is nothing ever lost in the message. His love is clear. His identity is true. And as a church, we have a responsibility to portraying and to explaining and to showing forth the character of Christ in the way we love one another, especially in the way we love ourselves. You know, something that we hope to share with the rest of the congregation in the next coming year is a series called The Chosen. And I happened to watch an episode last night, and the Roman guard that was leading the troops there said to Matthew the tax collector in the scene, he goes, "You're an interesting lot. You serve one God, but you can't get along with one another." Basically what he was saying. Yeah. In his mind, there was a discrepancy of this love of God and this seeking after God, and why can't it be seen in the people, in the lives with one another? You know? And so we have a responsibility, first and foremost, to love one another to exemplify the love of God, but then to take that love and to go out and to reach people. And someone who got that message was Paul. And so I want to share a portion of Scripture with you this morning that really speaks about going the distance in loving the people around him. And Paul went the distance. He went beyond. I believe he did things that many of us probably wouldn't consider doing at times, but he did. And listen to what he says from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 19 to 23. He says, "I am not anyone's slave." Now, he's not beholden to anybody. "But I have become a slave to everyone so that I can win as many people as possible." Verse 19, as many people as possible. He was a man who was free, but yet he would make himself a slave before others in living with them in order to reach them. In other words, he would allow himself to be constrained in his own life where he didn't have to be, but he would. "When I am with Jews," which he happened to be a Jew, but he's talking about those who are going to be under the law. "When I am with Jews, I live like a Jew to win Jews. They are ruled by the law of Moses, and I am not. But I live by the law to win them. And when I am with the people who are not ruled by the law, I forget about the law to win them. Of course, I never really forget about the law of God. In fact, I am ruled by the law of Christ." He is willing to live by the law when he's with those who are still under the law. He could say, "Listen, you people need to get with the program. Christ came. He changed my life. He could do the same for you. You need to get with the program. Follow me." But instead, he goes in, and he will even go along the regular practices of the law, even though he's been freed from them, in order to reach them. His love would go to such an extent that he would go to out of his way to do that, to reach them. And it was proven out on one of his journeys. He took Timothy, who was half Jew and half Gentile. And to Timothy, he said, "Listen, we're going to go into a city where there's a lot of Jewish population. And even though you don't have to be circumcised, I'm going to ask you to do that so that you're not a problem to them, that they'll receive you." In other words, what he was doing, he was instructing Timothy to follow his lead and follow his example. "You don't have to do this, but I'm asking you to do this so that you are able to reach a people who still don't know, who are still yet to experience." Because you see, that's what love does. He goes on to say, "When I am with the people whose faith is weak, I live as they do to win them. I do everything I can do to win everybody I can possibly. I do all this for the good news because I want to share its blessing." When you think about that, here is Paul who has come a long way in his faith, right? And yet he says that when he's with those who have not grown to his degree or to his measure, that he wouldn't tout it over them. He wouldn't make them feel small. He would actually go and be with them and instruct them lovingly so that they too could grow in their faith. You see, because that's what love does. And when he says, I do this for the good news, in essence, he's saying, I'm doing this for Christ. I'm doing for the one who came and who loved me and who showed me and who has nurtured me and has brought me along. You see, because that's the identity of Christ. And that's the identity that God is looking to form in each of us as we grow together. Now, Paul went through it in every city, because he was actually living the way Christ had instructed him to, and lived an example before the people of God. But I want to tell you, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy for Paul, and it wasn't easy for Christ, because you see, if it was left up to the religious leaders in Jesus' day, he would have boycotted everybody. Everybody. He would have not found any common ground with any people, because they didn't. They were aloof and they were distant from the people who needed God's love the most. And so I thought about some people that Jesus went after. Like the woman at the well. A woman in her life, whether you know the story or not, who couldn't get it right. One relationship after another relationship after another relationship. And yet, when Jesus met her, he has one of the longest recording conversations in scriptures. He spent time with her. In fact, many will say that he made it his business to be at the well at the hottest time of the day, when she would be there all alone because she was an outcast, to make sure that he would connect with her. Because that's what the love of God does. And then there was Matthew, the tax collector. A swindler, a traitor, a Roman collaborator. I was thinking about that today. I was thinking, man, I could have a start for a rap song here. Swindler, traitor, Roman collaborator. Yeah. I'll try that with the teens next week, see if it catches on. But that's what he was. That's what he was. And yet, Jesus took him in. I mean, he didn't just befriend him. He invited him in to his circle. I don't know if we could be able to do that. You and I, that is. Took him in, made him a part of the circle. And then beyond that, he sat down and had dinner with his cohorts. You know? Because that's what love does. And then there's the Roman centurion. And let's be real about it. He's a Roman and he's a soldier. A filthy, murdering pagan, basically. He had no belief in Christ, in the living God, in the God of Israel. And yet Jesus spoke with him and even offered to go into his home, which was unheard of. Which really twisted many of the religious people around Jesus. But you see, that's what love does. And like the lepers and the prostitutes, all the people that I brought up, and we can bring up more if we had more time, they are all outcasts. People that no one else wants to have anything to do with. And yet, God draws near to them. And we know that for a fact, because that's who Christ is. He is the love of God come to this earth. And he spends time with such people. You see, because he came to visit sinners. And I want to say to you today, the church does well, as we sit here, that we realize that no one in this house, or any house of worship today, regardless of where they go to worship, can sit there and say, not me. I'm not a sinner. Because it's not true. It's just not true. In fact, someone who would certainly never be perceived as a sinner said pretty much to his dying day that he was a sinner, Billy Graham. And I want to say to you, when you and I think that we're better than the rest of our culture and our society, just get in your car today and pull out and get on the Sunrise Highway. and have somebody cut you off. Yeah. And if you don't literally, tell me you're not tempted to maybe give them a sign. Yes. And it's not the sign of peace either. You know? And I only use that as an example to say that there are times when we get rubbed raw in our lives, when we get upset by other people, and our conduct and our response and our thought patterns are less than God honoring. And I'm just being real, because this is what I see when I get in the mirror. I know me too well, and human nature too well, to say that each of us are sinners, and each of us need this love of God. And it's this love of God, this visitation of the Christ, that has changed each of our lives. Because if he hadn't, we wouldn't be sitting here together today, for starters. And we would not take the time to even consider anything that is said from this pulpit. It's the love of God. And this love of God has the power to change your lives. You know it. You've experienced to one degree or one measure or another. And that's the whole purpose for his visitation, because love changes people's lives. Not judgment. And that's why Jesus went to love. And in many of these stories, we don't, except like for the woman at the well, we know that that had a great outcome, but we don't know what the outcome was for the centurion, and maybe for some of the lepers that were healed and never came back to say thank you. But God still shows his love, because that love has the power to change people's lives. And I would venture to say it's probably one of the only things that are going to change people's lives. So before we go today, I want to go to Isaiah chapter 11 with you and look at verses 1 to 2 for starters. And I want you to kind of think about the power of the love of God as I'm reading through this. And then we're going to read verses 6 to 8. And then I want you to think about the power to change people's lives. Right? But in verses 1 to 2, he says, "There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from its roots shall bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord." Now, think about a stump. Eugene Peterson helped me with this morning as I read through the message today. The stump. Nothing is really going to grow from that stump, because it is a severed tree. It's what's left over. But yet out of it, out of what's left over, God raises a shoot. Out of the stump of Israel, God brings forth life, and that life is Christ. And it is the power of God. It is the Spirit of God that is going to rest on him, that's going to fill him without measure. Wisdom and understanding, counsel and might, and knowledge, and all of this is going to make a difference in people's lives, because he's going to bring it and establish it, and he's going to do it because he's going to love a people who were loveless. And then we look at verses 6 to 8. Now I want to say to you that this is, listen to the metaphorical language, but think about the animals that are being brought forth in what Isaiah is about to say. "The wolf shall dwell with the lamb." Unheard of. "The leopard shall lie down with a young goat." Unheard of. "And the calf and the lion and the fatted calf together. And a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young shall lie down together. And the lion shall eat straw like an ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of a cobra. And the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den." In other words, a den of snakes. Metaphorical? Yes. But the message in it is that the love of God changes the playing field, changes the characters involved in the story. His power is able to change people's lives. And people who could never normally get along with one another can get along with one another, you know? And people who you and I most likely would have a hard time loving, God can show us the way to love them. Yeah. I couldn't help this week to think about a guy who I had met in aisle 13 at Lowe's some time ago, but I'll never forget him because he was very different. It was a guy in tall and thin, black leather pants, black motorcycle jacket. He had more punctures in his face for earrings than I could count, and tattoos to boot, and long brown blondish hair. And at first, he's not the kind of person I would be drawn to or find it easy to hang out with or talk. And I'm just being real with you. But I went there because I realized that's exactly the very thing that God would expect me to do. And I met him on his own ground, and I helped him. And instead of keeping my distance, I hope he didn't think I was weird, but I got up real close. Because I wanted to communicate with him, and I wanted to connect with him. Now, you could say, well, what came from that? I don't know. I don't know where that man is today. I didn't have an opportunity to tell him who I was or what was driving my heart, but I loved him. Some of you have the same opportunity today, tomorrow, the weeks to come. Some of you had this opportunity the past week at a 7-Eleven, you know, where you had met somebody who maybe you wouldn't normally talk to, or whatever they were involved in at the counter is not something that you entertain. But something inside kicked in, and you were moved to talk to that person, strike up a conversation, or do something kind, like pay for their coffee. Whatever it is, now you could walk away and say, "Well, gee, did you share the gospel with that person?" Well, the opportunity didn't come about. But it's still the love of God, and we never know what God can do with the love that we exemplify. And it's a lot better than being nasty and short and curt, or just standing a distance from that person and judging them in our hearts, like so many of the Pharisees and scribes did in that day, and even with Jesus, but he could hear them, you know? He knew what was going on. It's a lot better than that. And regardless if something comes up before us, visibly, that we can see that's changing or not, God calls us to love. God calls us to be his representatives, and that love is what's going to make a difference in our culture and in our world. Because when you do that, you're lighting a candle. You know? And you're giving a piece of the person of Christ that's in you away to someone else, because you're loving that person. Jesus walked away from that centurion, and God only knows what happened to his life. You could walk away from someone that you've said something kind to, or helped through a door, or showed some love, and you don't know what that might do and how that might affect somebody's life. But the results are God's. See, we'd like to see the outcome of something a lot of times when we interact with people, but we don't always get to see it. But we do these things. You love people, and then you commit it to God. See? And that's what Christ did. He came to love everybody. Did everybody get it? No. Will everybody get it? No. But his desire is that for people to get it. And that should be our desire too. In the midst of this crazy season, just to love people. So in a moment, Pastor Nick is going to make his way up, and he's going to sing a closing song. And we're going to do things just a little bit differently this morning. I'm going to come back up after he's done singing to close in prayer. But I encourage you to listen to the song and follow Pastor Nick's instructions.
I decided not to display words for this, but rather have you just listen to the words. Close your eyes if you like, but concentrate on the words of Mary, Did You Know? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. Oh, Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand. Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the presence of the Lamb. Oh, Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great I am. I am.
Did you know? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? I want to venture a guess. I don't think she knew that. Mary, did you know that this child that you're delivered, that you've delivered, will soon deliver you? I don't think she knew that either. I can't help but wonder that as close as we are to wherever we are in our faith with God today, that maybe we may not realize that there's some part of us that needs to be made new. That it's not, our journey is not based on how many years we've put into it and how far we've come, but that there's something new that God wants to do in our lives. And maybe, just maybe, there's something in our lives that God needs to deliver us from, regardless of how many years we've been at the faith. That there's something that deep down inside He wants to touch in us, you know, and heal and mend. And so I want to give you an opportunity this morning to pray with me. Only He knows where you are. I don't. I have a hard enough time figuring out where I am. But He knows where each of us are and what each of us need. And so this morning, I want to give you an opportunity to lift up your hearts and open them wide to His presence. Because He's been here from the start. And there's something, I believe, that He wants to touch us. There's some part of us that He wants to touch. And maybe even some part of us that really needs a healing, a deliverance. And so take a moment. Father, this morning, I believe that this quiet is a special moment. Lord, I wonder of the moments of quiet that Mary had between the visitation and the wrestling of Christ in her arms, and Lord, the quiet that she was able to experience. Lord, there was so much, oh God, I believe, that you were going to reveal to her. And Father, today, as we are together, oh God, we are a people. Whether we can identify it or even take hold of it right now at this moment, a people who are in need. Lord, in need of your presence in our lives, in need of your love. Oh God, are there areas in our lives where, Lord, where we struggle with your true identity? That is, Father, that we struggle with how you are able to love in ways that we struggle with. Father, but you are God who comes back over and over again and loves us regardless of our state of mind and attitude and our posture. Regardless of our picking and choosing, Lord God. Regardless of our human nature, Lord, you come, and for that reason you love us. Father, today, oh God, as you search our hearts, here and throughout the day, oh God, we invite you. We invite you, oh God, to make us new. Lord, we confess that it's your love that has changed our lives and have brought us to this point. And we confess, oh God, that in our desire to go further, we need your love to do so. And so help us. And Father, if there are any of us here, oh God, that struggle, that we are in need of a deliverance, oh God. Lord, we can think of some severe subjects, oh God, that require deliverance in a person's life, oh God. But Lord, is it me, my attitude, my mindset, how I perceive others, how I measure them, and even at times judge them, how I look at them or look down on them, that needs a deliverance, oh God? Because at this moment I identified that that's not who you are. That's not how you do life. And so, Father, help me and deliver me, oh God, that I might do life according to your will and walk in your ways. Now, Lord, I pray, oh God, as we go and we take the time to celebrate with friends and family this weekend and on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, oh God, that, Lord, our hearts would be refreshed and renewed, and that we would go with the gifts that you have given us, a renewed hope, a tremendous sense of peace and joy, and hearts that are filled with your love. And may those be gifts that we share with one another, as we sit around a table and eat and drink with one another, as we love one another. Father, we thank you for this time, this moment, and all that's gone on here today. And in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for listening. It's always great to be with you.